you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
Life is full of the unexpected. Have you noticed that? Events that we didn't plan for, things that we didn't expect. And when we face a challenge, we always have a choice. Don't panic, pray. Makes us realize that God is this huge answer and our problem suddenly becomes pretty small. It says he knows every star by name. So does he not know us? Of course he does. Does he not know about our problems? Of course he does. And you know what Job said, just to put all of this into perspective? He said, and these were some of the minor things. What are the major things? Come on, if he can put the stars in the sky and sustain them, then what's our problem? Let me make it even more personal. What's your problem? What is your problem? Because God can do it. Any human father that's a real father will turn their kids to God, because I can't answer every problem. I can't pay for every need. I can't resource you in every single situation, but I know someone who can. My daddy. My big daddy. Let's go back. Number five. Let me just say this before we go on. Magnifying our relationship with God enables us to realize who we are and what we have access to. As heirs of Christ, we have access to far more than what we've tapped. Wow. All right, number five. He magnified God's activity. Every line is a great encouragement in this scripture. He said to God, the one who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel. What was he doing? He was saying, listen, I know that you've already acted on behalf of people. So what was he doing? What we need to do, he's encouraging us to enlarge our memory of previous God activity in our lives. Come on, God has worked a miracle in every single one of us. We are a miracle, by the way. We are a miracle. We're a miracle every single day. We realize that this is a miracle. I want you to just say that about yourself. Say, I am a miracle. I want to encourage you online, if you're watching right now, just say, I am a miracle, because you truly are. Isn't it amazing? And if God can make this and make us in such an incredible, intricate way, then he can do everything that we need. Every single challenge that we face, God can perform a miracle. So he started to look at what God had done. What he's already done in the past and present is amazing. So what he'll do in the future will be awesome. He healed the sick. I'm just going to remind you of a couple of things, because we could be here all day just reciting what God's done. But he healed the sick. He raised the dead. Now, some of you have seen him heal the sick. I doubt that many of you have seen him raise the dead, but he can, and he has, and he will. He parted the sea so people could walk across it. He fed the 5,000, which they believe was probably nearer 20,000 by the time you add all the women and the kids. That was a pretty amazing miracle right there. So we're talking about, hang on, he can heal. He can bring back life. He can part the sea. He can make a way for us. He can provide for us by feeding us. Do you realize every day he's doing that anyway? We just don't see it. Every day he's making a way where there is no way. He's healing our disease even when we don't even realize we got it. I wonder how much disease he's healed in me and you. Because our faith is working all the time. And sometimes we don't need to be aware of such stuff that's going on. But one day God's going to go, do you know what? You had cancer in your body, but because of your faith, you healed. I healed you because your faith was at that level of believing over your own body. I tell you what, it's going to blow our minds. He's going to show us scenarios where our life could have really come to an end and he saved us. I really believe that about my life. There have been so many incidents when I shouldn't be here and God has done something. He brings back to life things that we need to be brought to life. There are scenarios in our life and we think that's over, it's dead, it's gone. And God brings back. Isn't it amazing how amazing God is? Thing is, we got to be in a place where we go, God, you must do what you must do. Remember, we say, His will, not my will. That's why we need to remember sometimes the Lord's Prayer. Your will be done. See, we don't like to give over that control. We'd really like our will to be done. But He says, no, I know the best for you. Your will. See, when you can have that relationship with God where we're like, God, I don't understand everything, and there are going to be things that you do that I don't want you to do, and there's going to be things that are going to take time to get over. But listen, if we can get to a place of saying, Your will be done. So magnifying previous activity enables us to be confident about future action. Number six, he magnified God's promise. He said, and he gave the land to the descendants of Abraham, who God was your friend forever. We need to enlarge God's promise over our lives. What he promised to a previous generation, he purposed for a present generation. Do you realize that we are seeing promises come into fruition? In fact, we are the promise of Abraham. Remember, Abraham was told, you know, at almost 100 years of age, he was told, you're going to have more descendants than the sand on the seashore. You won't even be able to count the amount of descendants. Do you realize we're those descendants? We are that miracle. We are that promise coming to fruition for Abraham. Abraham didn't even live the amount of years to see that promise. And you know that promise will go way beyond our lifetime. That's why it was more than the sand on the seashore. Can you imagine how that has been like one huge, humongous promise that's still come into fruition. Never think that God is over in your life just because of what you see. Can you imagine when Abraham went to be with God? He was thinking, well, that was great, God, but how about the rest of it? You know, he could have so easily thought, well, that was it. Little did he know what was going to go on after his lifetime that's still going on today. And I want to tell you, there are some things in your life that God has promised, and it's not over till it's over. Keep believing the promises of God because they are, listen, yes and amen. That's what the Bible says. All of God's promises are yes and amen. And the amazing thing that I read here was that he promised it to friends. Now, don't think of God as your friend like we know friends. We as human beings let each other down. But we're talking about a real, true friend who's true to his friends. He won't let them down. He'll never leave them. He'll never forsake them. That's a promise. How come God could promise that? Because he never has and he never will. He never will let anybody down. He will never forsake anybody. That's why I'm encouraging people watching online to give their lives to God, because he will be your best friend. He will never let you down. He will never leave you. I tell you what, to have that assurance in your life is just amazing. And it's available to everybody. To live every day knowing that God is my friend. I mean, you start looking like I did last night at those stars in the sky and go, my friend did that. Cool, if we're going to boast about anybody, let's boast about our friend God. Wow, my daddy did that. Isn't that amazing? Look at that. Do you ever look up and do that? If you don't, you ought to. Because it truly is amazing. My friend. My daddy did that. My daddy is my friend. The closest friend I will ever have. Won't let me down. Here's the thing. We're not just known to God. We're friends of God. I am a friend of God. What a great song. Going to sing it one day. Working hard on some songs right now. We're going to do that one. So magnifying God's promises will remind us that all his promises are yes and amen. Last thing, we got there. He magnified God's house. In verse 8, he says, and they dwell in it. He's talking about God's house. And have built you a sanctuary for your name, saying, if disaster comes upon us, sword, judgment, pestilence, or famine, or anything else for that matter, we will stand before this temple and in your presence, for your name is in this temple, and cry out to you in our affliction, and you will hear and save. What a great thing to say. I'm going to stand in your house, declaring in your presence, crying out to you in my affliction, knowing that you will heal and you will save. So we need to enlarge our priority to God's house. There's something about dwelling in God's house, hence the reason I'm going to do a series on it. Something different about dwelling in God's house, belonging to God's house, not just attending God's house, because when you belong to it, it belongs to you. God is building one thing, his church. He highly values his house. We are his church that meet in his house. His house is really where a group of believers come to gather together. It's not the building, but it's the gathering together. That's why it's so serious when people don't gather together. When they've once gathered together, but then through hurt or whatever, they don't gather together and they carry on their Christian life, but they never come to the house of God. And there's an importance of us coming together. I was interested that one of Nat's friends, one of Nat's really good friends, said something to me the other day, and she said, you know, we've got to come together as friends. We've got to draw together. And I said, absolutely. You come together in a time of need. And that's what church is. Coming together, not just for a time of need, but all the time. Because when this belongs, when you belong to this, it belongs to you. Magnifying God's house confirms to us it's the place where we should turn. It's the place where teaching is shared, counsel is given, and answers are found. It's so important that the perspective you have will determine where you turn and the advice you'll seek. Psalm 1 says this in verse 1, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. There are lots of well-meaning people out there, but someone who's not giving you godly advice is not necessarily giving you good advice. And sometimes even when they think they're giving you good advice, if it's not godly advice, it might not be the best advice. I want to get God advice. That's exactly what I'm saying through all of this, what Jehoshaphat was really saying right from the beginning. I seek God for the answer to my problem. As you read through the Bible, you find that people turn to God every step of the way. And God's people, the people who could give them God's answer. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. Well-meaning people are great, but they're not necessarily going to give you God advice. It's amazing when we get into God's house, surrounded by God's people, singing God's praise, receiving God's word, how quickly things can change. That's why we need to come together. We struggle to do that on our own, but when we come together, wow, even if we don't feel like it, it's only a few seconds before we're starting to get in the flow. We feel the godly nudge of people next to us. Come on, we're going to praise God. I know you're not feeling like it, but when did feelings ever make any difference? We're going to praise God, and we're going to declare his word, and we're going to pray to this God who holds the stars, holds the world in his hand. I know it's an old song, but he holds the whole world in his hand. Wow. Just going to finish by sharing this. I love the way that Jehoshaphat continued. In verse 12, he made this amazing statement. We are powerless against this mighty army. Now that's not being negative, that's just being real. That's being truly real. Why do I know that? Because of what he carried on to say. If he just stopped there, that would have probably been viewed as negative. We are powerless against this mighty army that's about to attack us. No, that was realism. He was powerless. This army was bigger. This problem was greater. But then, what does he do? And he says, we do not know what to do. It's okay to sometimes say, I do not know what to do. What are you doing? You're saying, I've run out of my own power. I don't have enough solution here for the problem. Here is the one thing, but we are looking to you, talking about God, for help. There's a positive counteracting what could be viewed as a negative. We are powerless. We don't know what to do, but praise God, you do. We're looking to you for help. Lord, in this situation with Mark, we feel powerless. We feel helpless. We don't know what to do, but we do know you do. And we don't just know that you know what to do. We know you can do it. And Lord, we're going to end this message today by praying online and believing that God, you are going to do something in Mark's life that will just astonish everybody. Father, we believe you can, and we're believing that you will. We're praying that you will. Father, we've got to put our belief out there. We've got to believe that all things are possible, because the opposite is believing that we're facing an impossible situation here, and we refuse to believe that. We refuse, Lord, to say, well, there's no hope. We always have hope when we have God. So, Father, today we are praying. We're not going to beg. We're just going to bring our petition before you. And we're praying for our friend, for our brother, Mark. Lord, such a close friend to this church. And Lord, I pray for him. And I pray that you would do master surgery on that brain, on that area of damage. And you would fix everything that needs to be fixed. That everything would flow like it needs to flow. That every bit of swelling will reduce in the name of Jesus. Lord, we don't even quite know how we can pray. But you say that even when we're like groaning, that you will make sense of what we're saying. And you will do, you hear every word, because you hear our heart. You don't just hear the words that are coming out of our mouths. So Father, we do feel like we're groaning. We're just kind of saying things that we don't quite know how to put it today in a way that would really get you to work. But Lord, we know that we don't have to get you to work, because you're already at work. And all we're doing is putting our faith out there, believing that you can do everything and anything. And we're praying, Father, and we're putting our faith out there to believe that you will do 100% of what you need to do. Father, we don't even want to believe for any less than 100% breakthrough, 100% miracle, 100% healing in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we're looking forward to receiving reports that you have done something incredible. And we're going to pray one last line, Lord, your will be done. Amen.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.